And the Torah portion for tonight is ואתחנן. I pleaded, and it's the Torah portion where Moses talks to the people about how he pleaded with the Lord that he would be allowed to go into the promised land. And of course, we know the Lord said no, and we'll talk about the reasons why later. But first, we'll take a look. It's found in Deuteronomy chapter 3, verse 23 through chapter 7, verse 11. The Haftarah portion is Isaiah 40, verse 1 through 26. The Brit Hadashah portion is Luke 22, verse 13 through 38. And first, we'll take a look at the pictograms and the gematria, and we'll see how the word ואתחנן actually talks about Yeshua HaMashiach, the Messiah. So we start out with the word ואתחנן, and the first letter of the word ואתחנן is the letter Vav. And we know that the letter Vav is a peg, and it means to add, to secure, or to hook. And we know that the letter Vav is also the number 6, which is the number of a man. Man was created on the 6th day. Okay, so that's the first thing. So we're going to be talking about a man that's secured or hooked to something. The second letter of the word, the ואתחנן, is a letter Aleph, and the pictogram is an ox head, which means the leader, the chief, or the strength. And in Scripture, we see that Yeshua HaMashiach is the Aleph and the Tav, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. He's the leader, the chief, and the strong one. Then we go to the next letter of the word, the ואתחנן, and we have the letter Tav. And the letter Tav is crossed poles and represents the tree of sacrifice, and it means a mark or a sign. And Yeshua said that if he was high and lifted up, he would draw all men unto himself. So in these first three letters here, we have the man who is the leader, the chief, and the strength, and he's going to be secured to the tree of sacrifice. Also, we see here that the one secured is the Aleph and the Tav, because that's the first two letters after the peg, the Aleph and the Tav. It's amazing, isn't it? The third letter we have, the fourth letter we have, is the letter Chet, which is a tent wall, and it means to divide, or it means half, or outside. And we know that when Yeshua was crucified, what did the thieves do?
They divided
his garments and his belongings, and they cast lots for his garment. He was also crucified where? Outside the city. The next letter is the letter Nun, which is a seed or sprout. And Yeshua HaMashiach is the son and the heir. Right? He's what? The heir of eternal salvation, right? He gives that to us. He gives us salvation. In fact, the word Yeshua means salvation. So it means son, heir, and continue. So what? And it's what? A seed or a sprout. So Yeshua was the seed, right? The first resurrected from the dead. And he said what? That whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life, right? And so we see this, the seed, the sprout, the son, the heir. And for the final letter of the ואתחנן, we have a final letter, Nun.
The ultimate.
The ultimate Nun, who is Yeshua.
Okay.
When we,
oh,
Okay, no, go ahead, Andrew.
I was thinking the root word is kanan, right?
Right.
So put those three together and what do you get?
Kanan.
I know, but you have...
Be gracious.
You have a tent wall. So that would be like protection.
Protection.
And then of the sun, of the... Mm-hmm. Of Yeshua, but it's like double protection. Then.
Right.
Because isn't it like mercy or like mercy?
And the other thing is this final noon can be 50 or it can be 700. And the 700 is 70 times 10. And later on we'll talk about the number 70 and how it represents Israel, which is another very important thing. And the 10 actually represents the 10 words of creation and the 10 words at Mount Sinai that were given to Moshe. And what we'll see here is the number 6 is man, the number 1 is Hashem, the number 400, if you break it down into 40 times 10, is testing and trial. The 40 is testing and trial. We know that during the time of Noah, it rained for 40 days and 40 nights. We know the children of Israel were in the wilderness for 40 years. We know Moses was up on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights twice. We know that Yeshua HaMashiach was tempted in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights. The number 8 is a new beginning. And it goes back to the covenant and how what? A Jewish boy is circumcised on the 8th day and becomes part of the covenant. And the number 50 is the counting of the Omer. From what? The day after the Sabbath of the Passover week until Shavuot. And it's also how many years there are between Jubilees, when everyone's land is supposed to be returned to them. So we have a lot in the gematria and in the pictograms here. The total gematria is 515. And the 5 represents grace and the 1 represents Hashem. So this whole Torah portion is about Hashem's grace to man that he came and he gave his life on the tree of sacrifice and shed his blood for the forgiveness of our sin. Right? So that if we believe in him, we have everlasting life. If we add up the digits, it adds up to 11. And 11 is one more than 10, and it's one less than 12. And it shows here that man has a problem if he doesn't follow Hashem's commandments. But if we add up these two digits, it adds up to 2, which goes back to the 2 tablets, which is the 10 words, and they represent the mitzvot. So if we do the mitzvot, we're okay. The other way, the gematria is 1165, and you have Hashem and man and grace. And if man accepts Hashem's grace, he has everlasting life. If he doesn't, what do we have here? The digits add up to 13. And what do you have? 12 is perfect government. What's 13?
13
is bad. Actually, in the gematria, 13 is tied in.
I thought 13 is the word ha-ha-ba, which is love.
Which is love. But there's also a tie-in with a lot of the evil lineages in the scripture and the gematria are divisible by 13, which is another interesting thing. But the final of it is, if you add up the two digits, 1 and 3, you get 4, which is creation. And creation is Hashem's witness to man that there is a God. And in this Torah portion, later on when we get to Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4, we'll see the Shema, right? Shema. Right, Shema Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. And we'll talk about that a little later on, and we'll talk about the witness of the heavens and the earth when we get up to Shema, and the word Ad, which means witness. But now we'll go through the scriptures that tie in with these pictograms. So, Angela, could you go ahead and read Psalm 22?
For the music director on the Doe of the Dawn, a Psalm of David. My God, why have you forsaken me? Distant from my salvation are the words of my groaning. O my God, I cried out by day, but you did not answer, by night, but there was no rest for me. Yet you are holy, enthroned on places of praise, on the praises of Israel. In you our fathers put their trust. They trusted, and you delivered them. They cried out to you, and were delivered. In you they trusted, and were not disappointed. Am I a worm, and not a man? Am I a scorn of men, despised by people? All who see me mock me. They curl their lips, shaking their heads. Rely on Adonai. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him, since he delights in him. Yet you brought me out of the womb, made me secure at my mother's breasts. From the womb I was cast on you. From my mother's womb you have been my God. Be not far from me, for trouble is near. There is no one to help. Many bulls have surrounded me. Strong bulls of Bashan encircled me. They open wide their mouths against me like a tearing, roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are disjointed. My heart is like wax, melting within my innards. My strength is dried up like a clay pot. My tongue clings to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death, for dogs have surrounded me. A band of evildoers has closed in on me. They pierced my hands and feet. I can count all my bones. They stare, they gape at me. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment. But you, Adonai, be not far off. O my strength, come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword, my only one from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, from the horns of the wild oxen, rescue me. I will declare your name to my brothers. I will praise you amid the congregation. You who fear Adonai, praise him. All Jacob's descendants, glorify him. Revere him, all you seed of Israel. For he has not despaired or disdained the suffering of the lowly one, nor has he hidden his face from him. But when he cried to him, he heard. From you is my praise in the great assembly. I will fulfill my vows before those who fear him. Let the poor eat and be satisfied. Let them who seek after him praise Adonai. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to Adonai. All the families of the nations will bow down before you. For the kingdom belongs to Adonai, and he rules over the nations. All the rich of the earth will feast and worship. Everyone who goes down to the dust will kneel before him, even the one who could not keep his own soul alive. His posterity will serve him, telling the next generation about my Lord. They will come and declare his righteousness to a people yet to be born, because he has done it.
Because he has not. Okay. Leonardo, could you go ahead and read Matthew
27:39?
Matthew 27:39. Yeah, 39 and 43. And that's the Brit Hadashah fulfillment of Psalm 22. Verse 7 and 8.
39 and 43 or 39, 30?
Yeah, go ahead and read 39 to 43.
Those passing by were jeering at him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are Ben Elohim, come down from the stake." Likewise, the ruling Kohanim along with the Torah scholars and elders, were also mocking him. He saved others, they were saying, but he can't save himself. He's the king of Israel. Let him come down from the stake and we'll believe him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now. If he wants him, for he said, I am Ben Elohim.
Mm. Okay.
Son of God.
Mm-hmm. Debbie, could you go ahead and read Isaiah 50?
Need the Bible.
Verse 4 through 11.
The Lord God has given me the tongue of disciples, that I may know how to sustain the weary one with the word. He awakens me morning by morning. He awakens my ear to listen as a disciple. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not disobedient, nor did I turn back. I gave my back to those who strike me, and my cheeks to those who pluck out the beard. I did not cover my face from humiliation and spitting. For the Lord God helps me, therefore I'm not disgraced. Therefore I've set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be ashamed. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up to each other. Who has a case against me? Let him draw near to me. Behold, the Lord God helps me. Who is he who condemns me? Behold, they will all wear out like a garment. The moth will eat them. Who is among you that fears the Lord, that obeys the voice of his servant, that walks in darkness and has no light? Let him trust in the name of the Lord and rely on his God. Behold, O you who kindle a fire, who encircle yourselves with firebrands, walk in the light of your fire, and among the brands you have set ablaze. This you will have for my hand, and you will lie down in torment.
Mm-hmm. And so there we have Isaiah chapter 50. Okay, Angela, could you go ahead and read Isaiah 53.
Who has believed our report? To whom is the arm of Adonai revealed? For he grew up before him like a tender shoot, like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nor beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, one from whom people hide their faces. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our pains, yet we esteemed him stricken, struck by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced because of our transgressions, crushed because of our iniquities. The chastisement for our shalom was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. We are all like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us turned to his own way. So Adonai has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, like sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. Because of oppression and judgment, he was taken away. As for his generation, who considered? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people, the stroke was theirs. His grave was given with the wicked, and by a rich man in his death. Though he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth, yet it pleased Adonai to bruise him. He caused him to suffer. If he makes his soul a guilt offering, he will see his offspring. He will prolong his days, and the will of Adonai will succeed by his hand. As a result of the anguish of his soul, he will see it and be satisfied by his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, will make many righteous, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion with the great, and he will divide the spoil with the mighty. Because he poured out his soul to death, and was counted with transgressors, for he bore the sin of many and interceded for our transgressors,
for the transgressors, right. Now that's right there in Isaiah 53, and you remember in the pictograms when we talked about the noon, how the noon was the seed or the sprout, and it meant son or heir, and to continue, we see in Isaiah 53:10, but the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief. If he would render himself as a gift offering, he will see his offspring, he will prolong his days, and the good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in his hand. So that goes right back here. Okay, let's go to Luke 22 in the Brit Hadashah. And in the first part of this, this is the Brit Hadashah portion that goes along with this Torah portion. And Luke 22, verse 13 to 38, talks about how Yeshua HaMashiach celebrated the Passover with his disciples. And how Yeshua told them what would happen at that Passover. And we also know that the Passover lamb was a type of Yeshua. Okay, but we're going to go on a little further into Luke chapter 22. And we'll have Leonardo go ahead and read. Starting at verse 21, go ahead and read to verse 38.
But look, the hand of the one betraying me is with mine on the table. For indeed the Son of Man is going as has been predetermined. But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed. So they began to discuss among themselves which of them it might be who would do this thing. But there was also a quarrel among them about which of them is considered the greatest. And Yeshua said to them, the kings of the nations have mastery over them, and those exercising authority over them are called benefactors. But with you it is not so. Rather, let the one who is greatest among you become like the youngest, and the one who leads like the one who serves. For who is greater, the one who reclines or the one who serves? Is it not the one who reclines? But I am among you as one who serves. You are the ones who have remained with me in my times of testing. And just as my Father has granted me a kingdom, so I grant to you that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you shall sit upon thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, indeed, Satan has demanded to sift you all like wheat. But I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith will not fail, that you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. But Simon said to him, Master, I am ready to go with you even to prison and to death. But Yeshua said, I tell you, Peter, a rooster will not crow today until you have denied me three times that you know me. That you know me. Through 34?
Up to 38. Keep going.
Oh. And he said to them, when I sent you out without a money pouch and travel bag and sandals, you didn't lack anything, did you? They said, no, nothing. Then he said to them, but now, whoever has a money pouch must carry it as well as a travel bag, and whoever does not own a sword must sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you that this which is written must be fulfilled in me, And he was counted with the lawless, for what is written about me is being fulfilled. And they said, Master, look here, two swords. And he said to them, it is enough.
It is enough. Mm-hmm. Okay. Debbie, go ahead and read verse 39 to 53.
And he came out and proceeded, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples also followed him. And when he arrived at the place, he said to them, pray that ye may not enter into temptation. And he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and began to pray, saying, Father, if thou art willing, remove this cup from me. Yet not my will, but thine be done. Now an angel from heaven appeared to him, strengthening him. And being in agony, he was praying very fervently, and his sweat became like drops of blood falling down upon the ground. And when he rose from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping from sorrow, and said to them, why are you sleeping? Rise and pray, that you may not enter into temptation. While he was still speaking, behold, a multitude came, and the one called Judas, one of the 12, was preceding them, and he approached Jesus to kiss him. But Jesus said to him, Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss? And when those who were around him saw what was going to happen, they said, Lord, shall we strike with the sword? And a certain one of them struck the slate with the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus answered and said, stop, no more of this. And he touched his ear and healed him. And Yeshua said to the chief priests and officers of the temple and the elders who had come out against him, have you come out with swords and clubs as against a robber? While I was with you daily in the temple, you did not lay hands on me. But this hour and the power of darkness are yours. Got to see Yeshua all along.
Okay. So we see here now, we'll start in verse 54, and having arrested him, they led him away and brought him to the house of the high priest. Peter followed at a distance, and over the next few verses, it speaks about how Peter denied Yeshua three times, just as Yeshua had prophesied. Okay, and then in verse 63, and the men who were holding Yeshua in custody were mocking him and beating him. They blindfolded him and were asking him, saying, prophesy, who is the one who hit you? And they did many other things against him, blaspheming. And when it was day, the council of the elders of the people assembled, both chief priests and scribes, and they led him away to their council chamber. If you are the Messiah, tell us. But he said, if I tell you, you will not believe. And if I ask a question, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God. And they said, are you the Son of God? And he said, yes. And then they accused him of blasphemy at that point, which wasn't true because he really is the Messiah. In Luke chapter 23, because the Jewish people had lost the power to inflict the death penalty, they had to go to Pilate, the Roman
governor.
And the whole body of them arose and brought him before Pilate. And they accused him, saying, we found this man misleading our nation and forbidding to pay taxes to Caesar, and saying that he is the Messiah and a king. And Pilate asks him, saying, are you the king of the Jews? And Yeshua answered, it is as you say. And Pilate said to the priests and the multitudes, I find no guilt in this man. And they kept on insisting. And when Pilate heard it, he asked whether the man was a Galilean. And when he heard that he belonged to Herod's jurisdiction, he sent Yeshua to Herod. And Herod was glad when he saw Yeshua, because he wanted to see him for a long time, because he had heard about him and wanted to see some sign performed by him. And when Herod questioned Yeshua, he said nothing. And the chief priests and scribes accused him, and Herod with the soldiers, after treating him with contempt and mocking him, dressed him in a gorgeous robe and sent him back to Pilate. And Herod and Pilate became friends with one another that very day. Before that, they had been enemies.
Find a way to be friends.
And so Yeshua's returned to Pilate. Pilate summoned the priests, and he said, "You brought this man to me as one who incites the people to rebellion. And behold, I have examined him. I have found no guilt in this man regarding the charges that you make, nor has Herod, for he sent him back to me. Nothing deserving of death was done by him. I will therefore punish him and release him." At this point, Pilate was obliged to release to the people one prisoner at the feast, and they cried out, saying, "Away with this man," and release the man Barabbas. Pilate, wanting to release Yeshua, addressed them again, but they cried out, "Crucify him." And he said to them the third time, "Why, what evil has he done?" And they continued to demand his death. They were insistent with loud voices that he be crucified. And so Yeshua was crucified, he was led away. And it said a great multitude of people followed, and people were mourning and lamenting him. But Yeshua told them, "Daughters of Jerusalem, stop weeping for me and weep for yourselves and your children. For behold, the days are coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' And they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do these things in the green tree, what happens in the dry?" And here he was speaking of the future, where the Romans would come in and destroy the temple and conquer the city, which was about 40 years later. It says that, "And two others also who were criminals were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right, one on the left. And Yeshua spoke out and said, 'Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing.' And they cast lots, dividing up his garments among themselves. And the people stood by and looked on. He saved others, let him save himself, if this is the Messiah of God, his chosen one. And the soldiers mocked him and offered him sour wine, saying, 'If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself.' And an inscription was put above him, 'This is the King of the Jews.'" In the book of John, it says that the inscription was, "Yeshua of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." And in that particular case, the Hebrew is Yeshua HaNotzri V'Melech HaYehuda. And the acrostic of those words forms the tetragrammaton Yod Hey Vav Hey. So we see here Yeshua was on the cross, and he gave his life on that cross. And in the crucifixion, his hands and feet were nailed to the tree of sacrifice, just like this peg we have in the pictogram. In chapter 24, we have the resurrection of Yeshua. Angela, could you go ahead and read chapter 24, verse 1 through 12?
Luke. In the wrong book. I wonder if I can find it. What's the verses?
Even the cell phone takes time.
1 through 12.
Luke 24, 1 through 12.
"Now on the first day of the week, at daybreak, the women came to the tomb carrying the spices they had prepared. They found the stone had been rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Yeshua. And while they were perplexed about this, suddenly two men in dazzling clothes stood beside them. The women were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you search for the living among the dead? He is not here, but he is risen. Remember what he told you when he was still in Galilee, saying that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be executed and on the third day rise up?" And they were reminded of his words. And when they returned from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to everyone else. Now it was Miriam from Magdala and Joanna, the Miriam of Jacob, and the others together with them who were telling these things to the emissaries. But these words appeared to them as nonsense, but they would not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb. Leaning in, he sees only the linen cloths, and he went away to his home, marveling at what had happened.
Okay, Leonardo, could you go ahead and read verse 12 through 32?
Now behold, two of them on that very day were traveling to a village named Emmaus, a distance of about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were speaking with one another about all the things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Yeshua himself approached and began traveling with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. Then he said to them, "What are these things you are discussing with one another as you are walking along?" They stood still, looking gloomy. Then the one named Cleophas answered and said to him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who doesn't know the things that have happened there in these days?" Yeshua said to them, "What kind of things?" And they said to him, "The things about Yeshua from Nazareth, who was a prophet, powerful indeed in word before God and all the people, how the ruling Kohanim and our leaders handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they executed him. But we were hoping that he was the one about to redeem Israel. Besides all this, today is the third day since these things happened. But also some women were among us amazed us. Early in the morning they were at the tomb. When they didn't find his body, they came saying that they had also seen a vision of angels who said he is alive. Some of those with us went to the tomb and found it, just as the women said, but they did not see him. Yeshua said to them, "O foolish ones, so slow of heart to put your trust in all that the prophets spoke. Was it not necessarily for Messiah to suffer these things and to enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them the things written about himself in all of the scriptures. They approached the village where they were going, and he acted as though he was going on further. But they urged him, saying, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening and the day already gone." So he went in to stay with them, and it happened that when he was reclining at the table with them, he took the matzah, offered a bracha, and breaking it, gave it to them. Then their eyes were open, and they recognized him, and he disappeared from them.
Okay.
That was through 31. Is that where you...
Yeah, that's fine. Okay. Go ahead and read verse 33 to 43. Okay.
And they arose that very hour and returned to Jerusalem and found gathered together the 11 and those who were with them, saying, "The Lord is really risen and has appeared to Simon." And they began to relate their experiences on the road and how he was recognized by them in the breaking of the bread. And while they were telling these things, He himself stood in their midst. But they were startled and frightened and thought they were seeing a spirit. And he said to them, Why are ye troubled, and why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still could not believe it for joy, and were marveling, he said to them, Have you anything here to eat? And they gave him a piece of a broiled fish. And he took it and ate it before them.
Okay.
Fish for breakfast.
And so,
yes, sir.
And so here we have the crucifixion, the crucifixion and the resurrection of Yeshua. And now we'll go to this Torah portion, ve'etkanan. And the first part of this that I want to go to, I want to skip right now to Deuteronomy chapter 6. And then we'll go back to the beginning of the Torah portion. Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 4. Angel, would you go ahead and read Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4?
Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one.
Okay. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, Hashem is the one and only. Continues, you shall love Hashem your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all of your resources. Now, when we take a look at the scriptures in Deuteronomy 6, 4, we find something very interesting. So what do we find here in Deuteronomy 6, 4? We find in the word Shema an enlarged letter ayin, right? And in the word Echad, we find a large letter dalet, right? Now, what do those things represent? That's what we're going to talk about for a few minutes right now. Because the ayin. Okay, first we'll start out. The letter ayin is the last letter of the word Shema.
Yep.
And the ayin signifies an eye, or the center of understanding. And the letter ayin is the number 70. And they say that the number 70 represents Israel and the restoration of the nation of Israel. In Strong's, okay, the definition, okay, of ayin is a fountain, the eye of a landscape, and Israel is what? Israel is the apple of God's eye, right? And it also means to look, to be humble, it means knowledge, it means regard, to sight, it means a resemblance, it means to face. It means countenance, it also means presence. It also means to be content. And we have all of these things in this letter ayin. Now the letter dalet in the word echad signifies a doorway. And we know that Yeshua HaMashiach is the door. We find that in John chapter 10. And the letter Dalet is the number 4, which represents God's creative works. And it looks like a tent opening, and it represents the tribe of Judah, the tribe that the Messiah is to come from. But when we take these two letters, the ayin and the letter dalet, it forms the word ad, which means witness. So the word ad means witness. And if we take a look at the gematria for the word ad, the gematria for the word ad adds up to 74. And the number 4 is creation, and the number 7 is completion and perfection. And we know that when God created everything, it was all good, it was all perfect. And on the 7th day, he rested from all his creative works, and the 7th day we know is Shabbat, right? Mm-hmm. Now, when we take a look at this, who just read? Angela did. Okay, Leonardo, could you go ahead and read Genesis 1:1 for us?
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth.
God created the heavens and the earth, right? Mm-hmm. And that's the number 4, the creation, right? Now let's take a look at something else here. Debbie, can you go to Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 26? It's part of our Torah portion.
I appoint heaven and earth this day to bear witness against you, that you will surely perish quickly from the land to which you are crossing the Jordan to possess. You shall not have lengthy days upon it, for you will be destroyed. Not very cheery.
No, that's not very cheery, but here it says what? This word ad, with the large letter ayin at the end of the word Shema, the large letter dalet at the end of the chad, meaning witness, okay? We know Genesis 1:1, God created the heavens and the earth to be a witness to man that there was a God, and there's only one God. And here, what did Moses say in Deuteronomy 4:26? He called heaven and earth to bear witness. Okay, Angela, could you go ahead and read Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 19.
I call the heavens and the earth to witness about you today that I have set before you life and death, the blessing and the curse. Therefore, choose life so that you and your descendants may live.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Leonardo, can you go ahead and read Deuteronomy 31:28?
Gather to me all the elders of your tribes and your officials so that I may speak these words in their ears and call heaven and earth to witness against them.
Okay, Debbie, could you go ahead and read Deuteronomy 32, verse 1?
Give ear, O heavens, and I will speak, and may the earth hear the words of my mouth.
May the earth hear the words of my mouth.
There's a trend going on here.
There's a trend going on here. Okay, back to Angela. Could you go ahead and read Psalm 50, verse 4?
He calls to the heavens above and to the earth to judge his people.
So he called to what? To the heavens above and to who?
To the earth.
And to the earth to what?
To judge.
To judge his people. Okay. Leonardo, can you go ahead and read Isaiah chapter 1, verse 2?
Listen, heavens, And hear, earth, for Adonai has spoken. Sons I have raised and brought up, but they have rebelled against me.
Hmm. And so here we have what Moses did in this Torah scroll, is he put a large letter iron and a large letter dalet as a witness to the children of Israel that he called heaven and earth to receive his word and to be a witness to them. And it all ties right together. Now remember back here in the Gematria, Hashem gives us grace, right? He asked them to what? To choose life, right?
Amen, yes.
And many of them did choose life. Okay, now we go back. What we saw in this Gematria for the word ve'etkanan, we saw in one case the digits added up to 11, and in another case they added up to 13. And the final result was 2, which represents what? The 2 tablets, the 10 commandments, the 10 words, which represent the mitzvot. In the other case, the digits add up to 4, representing the creation. And so what Hashem did is what? He spoke his words to what? To his creation, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So if the people listened, they would see the testimony of his words. They would see the testimony of his words in his creation, that he created the heavens and the earth. And if they didn't, we have the number 11, which is one less than 12, okay? 12 is perfect government. 11 is one less. 13 is one more. And what happens there, we can go to Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 2. Who are we up to now? Debbie. Go ahead and read Deuteronomy 4, verse 2.
You shall not add to the word that I command you, nor shall you subtract from it, to observe the commandments of Hashem your God that I command you.
Okay. Angela, could you go ahead and read Revelation 22, verse 18 to 21?
I testify to everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book. If anyone adds to them, God shall add to him the plagues that are written in this book. And if anyone takes away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his share in the tree of life and the holy city, which are written in this book. The one giving testimony to these things says, yes, I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Yeshua. May the grace of the Lord Yeshua be with all.
Ah, and so here we find out what this large letter iron and this large letter dalet is really all about, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was pretty amazing. And actually what it is, it's a picture that Moses put in there that he called, not only he spoke it, and it's written in the Torah, obvious and straightforward that he called heaven and earth to be a witness, but he put it right in the lettering of the Torah scroll.
Yeah, sure.
And it, when you dig deeper into it, it ties right into the heaven and the earth and about adding or subtracting from the word. And so, there's a lot in this Torah portion. Okay. And just remember, Israel, although Israel has gone through all of these things, the scripture promises that all Israel will be saved, and that Israel will be restored, and that the Messiah will come and establish his temple on Mount Zion, and he will rule and reign on the earth. So, no matter what this sounds like, there's a day coming. The Messiah is coming, and as we have there in Revelation chapter 22, he's coming very soon, very soon. And he says in his word that what's he going to do?
He's going to rule and reign.
He's going to raise up all the dry bones.
Yep.
And he's going to bring them back to their land.
That's
and he's going to save, according to his word, he's going to save every single one of them. Right? Says all Israel shall be saved. What? Go ahead.
There's a plane load of people on where to Israel right this minute, right this second.
Yep.
They're going to land at Ben-Gurion tomorrow morning, about a couple hundred people from this part of the world.
Yep.
Go to live in Israel. Bless them and save me, Yeshua.
Okay. And I just wanted to...
I've read that in the Bible.
I just wanted to go through this before we go back to the beginning of the Torah portion and start that. I don't know how much time we have left, but we'll do what we can.
It's 8:03.
8:03, okay. We have time to get a little bit done then. Okay. Where are we now? Back to Angela, okay. Go ahead back to Deuteronomy chapter 3, and go ahead read verse 23 to 29.
I implored Hashem at that time, saying, "My Lord, Hashem Elohim, you have begun to show your servant your greatness and your strong hand. For what power is there in the heaven or on the earth that can perform according to your deeds and according to your mighty acts? Let me now cross and see the good land that is on the other side of the Jordan, this good mountain and the Lebanon." But Hashem became angry with me because of you, and he did not listen to me. Hashem said to me, "It is too much for you. Do not continue to speak to me further about this matter. Ascend to the top of the cliff and raise your eyes westward, northward, southward, and eastward, and see with your eyes. For you shall not cross this Jordan, but you shall command Joshua and strengthen him and give him resolve. For he shall cross before this people, and he shall cause them to inherit the land that you will see." So we remained in the valley opposite Beth Peor.
Okay. So now, what's imploring? He implored the Lord. So Moses was praying, right?
Mm-hmm.
All through the Torah, we've seen Moses praying constantly, right?
Mm-hmm.
All through the Torah. And here, Moses goes before the Lord, and he says, "Your servant, you've shown your servant what your strong hand and power," because what did he just do?
Sihon and Og
defeated the Midianites. The Lord took them through all of these battles, all this land on the east side of the Jordan, which wasn't really the land that Hashem promised to them, was it?
Keep going a little more.
But they conquered all of that territory.
Mm-hmm.
And, but Moses asked the Lord, let me cross and go over on the other side. But the Lord said, no. And who did Moses blame it on?
The people.
He blamed it on the people, right?
Kind of did.
But it was because of the actions that he took. But there's several different opinions of the sages of what the Lord was really telling Moses here. and it's in the Chumash, and Angela, could you go ahead and just read the notes on verse 26 in the Chumash for chapter 3?
Yes. It is too much for you. By saying this, God forbade Moses to continue such prayers, lest people say that the master is unduly harsh and the student is unduly persistent. Alternatively, it could be rendered, there is so much for you. For example, God assured Moses that an enormously abundant reward, greater even than the land, awaited him in the world to come.
Hmm. So what does the Lord say? That whenever we do something, what did Yeshua say in the Brit Hadashah? Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust corrupt and where thieves break through and steal, but where does he say to lay up your treasures?
In heaven.
In heaven, right? Mm-hmm. In the world to come. And so, all through Moses' life, what did Moses do? He was laying up treasures whenever he interceded for the children of Israel. Mm-hmm. Whenever he taught them the mitzvot, he was laying up treasures in heaven. And they say basically what Hashem was telling Moses is, don't worry about it.
Yeah.
You have this great, incredible, awesome reward. There's nothing else I can do.
Yeah.
I mean, it's amazing. You'll see it when you get to the other side, Moses. It's okay.
I looked it up in Strong's too, and it said, let it suffice.
Let it suffice. Let your reward be enough.
Yeah.
Okay. Just let your reward be enough. And we know what? Moses was the only man that did what? How many people spoke face to face with Hashem?
He's it.
Moses,
he's
right?
It. Yeah.
What happened when Miriam and Aaron questioned Moses? And the Lord came down and got on their case, right?
Mm-hmm.
And said, when I speak to a man or somebody, I give them visions and dreams and words to say, but I speak with Moses as a man speaks to another man face to face.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah. Mm.
That's close.
Someday, yeah.
That's amazing. And we know also what Moses went up on Mount Nebo, right?
Uh-huh.
To see the land. And what does Hashem tell him? He tells him, look westward, northward, southward, and eastward to see the land.
To me, he's standing in the land.
So that means he has to be standing in the middle of the land, right?
So he did get to go.
See, actually what they say here at this particular point, okay, God promised them the land of Canaan. And you remember the Reubenites and the tribe of Gad and part of Manasseh. They got the pasture land on the east side of the Jordan. And all of that land, because they were obedient to the command to go in with the other tribes and conquer the land, they got their inheritance on the east side of the Jordan. And that all became part of the land of Israel. So, speaking in the future tense, when Moses was standing on Mount Nebo, he was standing in the middle of Israel. But the other half of it wasn't added in until after they conquered the land of Canaan and the tribe of Reuben and Gad were allowed to go back and possess their land. Because if they didn't go and fight with their brothers against the Canaanites, what did Moses say? If you don't fight with your brothers against the Canaanites and conquer the land with them, you get your inheritance on the west side of the Jordan. But because they fulfilled the vow that they made and went with the other tribes and fought against the Canaanites, they received their inheritance on the east side. So when Moses was up on Mount Nebo, he was right smack in the middle of the land. Of course, later on we know in the Brit Hadashah, he shows up on the Mount of Transfiguration.
Yeah, so he's right.
With Peter, James, and John, or with Yeshua, and you have Yeshua, and who? Elijah, and Moses.
Doesn't get much better than that.
Nope. Doesn't get any better than that, right? And so Moses strengthens Joshua and helps him. Now there's something else about this too. In one of the Torah portions by one of the rabbis, it talks about the prayer of Moses, and it talks about rejected prayers. And there's something interesting about this gematria for the word ve'etkanan. The gematria adds up to 515. And it talks about, if I can find this real quick here. It says somewhere here. Anyway, okay, here we go here. But they say, take a guess how many times Moses prayed that he would be allowed to go into Canaan.
515.
Yeah, they say that he prayed 515 times. Which is the gematria for the word ve'etkanan. Yeah. So I thought it's pretty amazing how everything ties together, isn't it?
He doesn't think I really guessed.
Well, you did it.
I did.
And here they are, they're sitting in the valley. They're sitting in the valley and they're opposite Beth Peor, the pagan god, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Leonardo, can you go ahead and read chapter 4, verse 1 through 4.
Now, O Israel, listen to the statutes and ordinances that I am teaching you to do, so that you may live and go in and possess the land that Adonai, the God of your fathers, is giving you. You must not add to the words that I am commanding you or take away from it, in order to keep the mitzvah of Adonai, your God, that I am commanding you. Your eyes have seen what Adonai did at Baal Peor, for Adonai your God has destroyed from among you everyone who followed Baal Peor. But you who know held tight to Adonai your God are alive today, all of you.
Okay. And what does that refer back to? That refers back to the Torah portion where Pincus took a stand and what killed Zimri and Cosby, but there were 24,000 Israelites that died at that time, right?
Right.
But because of the action Pincus took and those that followed his example, the plague was stopped. And all of the people that were involved with Baal Peor died in the plague. And here where it talks about, it says, decrees and ordinances, the decrees are things that Hashem has required, okay, that man really has no explanation for. They're done because Hashem says so. Mm-hmm. Because he knows what's best, right? And the ordinances are all the different rules and regulations and laws that a society needs to be able to live under,
to function,
to be able to function in a godly way. Okay? It says, don't add to the words, don't subtract from them. Be obedient to all the mitzvot. Okay? And you don't need to go add more.
No, just planting that.
There's enough to do to keep what's here.
Yeah,
so we should
get started.
That's right.
Okay, Debbie, go ahead and read verse 5 through 10.
See, I've taught you decrees and ordinances as Hashem, my God, has commanded me, to do so in the midst of the land to which you come to possess it. You shall safeguard and perform them, for it is your wisdom and discernment in the eyes of the peoples, who shall hear all these decrees and who shall say, surely, a wise and discerning people is this great nation. But which is a great nation that has a God who is close to it, as is Hashem our God whenever we call to him? And which is a great nation that has righteous decrees and ordinances, such as this entire Torah that I place before you this day? Only beware for yourself and greatly beware for your soul, lest you forget the things that your eyes have beheld, unless you remove them from your heart all the days of your life and make them known to your children and your children's children. The day that you stood before Hashem your God at Horeb, when Hashem said to me, gather the people to me and I shall let them hear my words, so that they shall learn to fear me all the days that they live on the earth, and they shall teach their children.
Okay. Angela, verse 11 through 20.
So you approached and stood at the foot of the mountain, and the mountain was burning with fire up to the heart of heaven, darkness, cloud, and thick cloud. Hashem spoke to you from the midst of the fire. You were hearing the sound of words, but you were not seeing a likeness, only a sound. He told you of his covenant, and he commanded you to observe the 10 declarations. And he inscribed them on 2 stone tablets. Hashem commanded me at the time to teach you decrees and ordinances, that you shall perform them in the land to which you cross to possess it. But you shall greatly beware for your souls, for you did not see any likeness on that day Hashem spoke to you at Horeb from the midst of the fire, lest you act corruptly and you make for yourselves a carved image, a likeness of any shape, a form of a male or a female, a form of any animal that is in the earth, a form of any winged bird that flies in the heaven, a form of anything that creeps on the ground, a form of any fish that is in the water under the earth, lest you raise your eyes to the heaven and you see the sun and the moon and the stars, the entire legion of heaven, and you be drawn astray and bow to them and worship them, which Hashem your God has apportioned to all the peoples under the entire heaven. But Hashem has taken you and withdrawn you from the iron crucible from Egypt to be a nation of heritage for him as this very day.
Okay, so the Lord what? He chose Israel to what? To be a holy nation before him. Okay. Leonardo, go ahead and read verse 21 through 24.
Furthermore, Adonai was angry with me because of your words, and he swore that I would not cross over the Jordan or enter the good land that Adonai your God has given you for an inheritance. For I must die in this land. I am not crossing over the Jordan, but you will cross over and take possession of the good land. Watch yourselves so that you do not forget the covenant of Adonai your God, which he cut with you, and make for yourselves a graven image in the form of anything that Adonai your God has forbidden you. For Adonai your God is a consuming fire, a jealous God.
Hmm. So what's he saying there? He's emphasizing there, no idolatry, right?
Mm-hmm. Nope.
Okay, Debbie, go ahead and read verse 25 through 28.
When he beget children and grandchildren, and will have been a long in the land, you will grow corrupt and make a carved image, a likeness of anything, and you will do evil in the eyes of Hashem your God to anger him. I appoint heaven and earth this day to bear witness against you, that you will surely perish quickly from the land to which you are crossing, the Jordan to possess. You shall not have lengthy days upon it, for you will be destroyed. Hashem will scatter you among the peoples, and you will be left few in number among the nations where Hashem will lead you. There you will serve gods, the handiwork of man, of wood and stone, which do not see and do not hear and do not eat and do not smell.
And so here, what do we have? The greatest prophet, Moses, making a prophecy to the children of Israel of what? that they would be scattered among all of the nations of the earth.
Yeah. Okay, Angela, that you will serve other gods.
Angela, go ahead and read verse 29 to 35.
From there you will seek Hashem, your God, and you will find him, if you search for him with all your heart and all your soul. When you are in distress and all these things have befallen you, at the end of days you will return unto Hashem your God and hearken to his voice. For Hashem your God is a merciful God. He will not abandon you nor destroy you. He will not forget the covenant of your forefathers that he swore to them. For inquire now regarding the early days that preceded you, from the day when God created man on the earth and from one end of heaven to the other end of heaven. Has there ever been anything like this great thing, or has anything like it been heard? Has a people ever heard the voice of God speaking from the midst of the fire as you have heard and survived? Or has any God ever miraculously come to take for himself a nation amidst a nation, with challenges, with signs, and with wonders, and with war, and with a strong hand, and with an outstretched arm, and with greatly awesome deeds, such as everything that Hashem your God did for you in Egypt? You have been shown in order to know that Hashem, he is God. There is none beside him.
Mm.
Hallelujah.
Awesome, right?
Yes.
Because right here, okay, in the previous scripture that we read, yes, Moses makes a prophecy that the children of Israel will be scattered, but he also makes a prophecy that they'll all return to Hashem and be reestablished back in their land.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Okay, Leonardo, go ahead and read 36 to 40.
From the heavens he made you hear his voice to instruct you, and on earth he caused you to see his great fire. You heard his words from the midst of the fire. Because he loved your fathers, he chose your descendants after them. Then he brought you out from Egypt with his great presence by his great power to drive out from before you nations greater and mightier than you, to bring you in to give you their land for an inheritance, as it is this day. So you will know today and take to heart that Adonai, he is God in the heavens above and on the earth below. There is no other. You must keep his statutes and his mitzvah, which I am commanding you today, so that it may go well with you and your children after you, and so that you may prolong your days in the land that Adonai your God has given you for all time.
Okay. Debbie, go ahead and read verse 41 through 49.
Then Moses set aside three cities on the bank of the Jordan toward the rising sun, for a killer to flee there, who will have killed his fellow without knowledge, but who is not an enemy of his from yesterday and before yesterday. Then he shall flee to one of these cities and live. Bezer in the wilderness in the land of the plain of the Reubenite, Ramoth in the Gilead of the Gadite, and Golan in the Bashan of the Manassite. This is the teaching that Moses placed before the children of Israel. These are the testimonies, the decrees, and the ordinances that Moses spake to the children of Israel when they left Egypt, on the bank of the Jordan in the valley, opposite Beth Peor, in the land of Sihon, king of the Amorite, who dwells in Heshbon, whom Moses and the children of Israel smote when they went out of Egypt. They possessed his land in the land of Og, king of Bashan, two kings of the Amorite, which are on the bank of the Jordan, where the sun rises, from a war that is by the shore of Arnon Brook until Mount Sion, which is Hermon, and the entire Arabah, the eastern bank of the Jordan, until the Sea of the Arabah, under the waterfalls of the cliffs.
Mm-hmm. And so.
That's pretty far apart, all that.
Yeah, that's.
Hermon's way over the ways.
A lot of women. Okay. Where are we at now? Chapter 5. Uh-huh. Okay, Angel, we'll go ahead and read verse 1 through 5.
Moses called all of Israel and said to them, "Hear, O Israel, the decrees and the ordinances that I speak in your ears today. Learn them and be careful to perform them. Hashem, our God, sealed a covenant with us at Horeb. Not with our forefathers did Hashem seal this covenant, but with us, we who are here, all of us alive today, face to face did Hashem speak with you on the mountain from amid the fire. I was standing between Hashem and you at that time to relate the word of Hashem to you, for you were afraid of the fire and you did not ascend the mountain, saying." Did you say 5?
Yeah, I'll have Leonardo go ahead and read verse 6.
I am Adonai your God, who brought you out from the land of Egypt, from the house of bondage.
Keep on going.
I'll keep going. You shall not have other gods beside me. Do not make for yourself a graven image, no image of what is in the heavens above or on the earth below or in the water under the earth. Do not bow down to them or worship them, for I am Adonai your God, am a jealous God. This is a theme, the iniquity of the fathers on the children and on the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing loving kindness to a thousand generations of those who love me and keep my mitzvah. You must not take the name of Adonai your God in vain, for Adonai will not leave unpunished anyone who takes his name in vain. Observe Yom Shabbat to keep it holy, as Adonai your God commanded you. 6 days you are to labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Shabbat to Adonai your God. In it you are not to do any work, nor not you, or your son, or your daughter, or your slave, or your maid, or your ox, or your donkey, or any of your livestock, or the outsider within your gates, so that your slave and your maid may rest as you do. You must not remember that you are a slave. You must remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and Adonai your God brought you out from there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, Adonai your God commanded you to keep Yom Shabbat. Honor your father and your mother, just as Adonai your God commanded you, so that your days may be long and it may go well with you in the land of Adonai your God is giving you. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness against your neighbor. Do not covet your neighbor's wife, nor desire your neighbor's house, his field, his manservant, his maidservant, his ox, his donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. These words Adonai spoke to all your assembly on the mountain from the midst of the fire, the cloud and the fog, with a great voice. He added no more. He wrote them on two tablets of stone and gave them to me.
Okay. It says, it happened that when you heard the voice from the midst of the darkness and the mountain was burning in fire, that you, all the heads of your tribes and your elders, approached me. And you said, behold, Hashem our God has shown us his glory and his greatness, and we have heard his voice from the midst of the fire. And this day we saw that Hashem will speak to a person and he can live. But now, why should we die when this great fire consumes us? If we continue to hear the voice of Hashem our God any longer, we will die. For is there any human that has heard the voice of the living God speaking from the midst of the fire as we have and lived? You should approach and hear whatever Hashem our God will say, and you should speak to us whatever Hashem our God will speak to you. Then we shall hear, and we shall do. And Hashem heard the sound of your words when you spoke to me. And Hashem said to me, I heard the sound of the words of this people that they have spoken unto you, and they did well in all that they have spoken. Who can assure that his heart should remain theirs, to fear me and observe all my commandments all the days, so that it should be good for them and for their children forever? Go, say to them, return to the tents. But as for you, stand here with me, and I shall speak to you the entire commandment and the decrees and ordinances that you shall teach them, and they shall perform them in the land that I give them to possess it. You all shall be careful to act as Hashem your God commanded you. You shall not stray to the right or the left. On the entire way that Hashem your God commanded you shall you go, so that you shall live, and it will be good for you, and you shall prolong your days in the land that you shall possess. Amen.
Amen.
Angela.
Yes.
Okay, where are we at now on our time?
8:34.
Do you want to continue, or okay, Angela, go ahead. Chapter 6, verse 1 through 6.
This is the commandment and the decrees and the ordinances that Hashem your God commanded to teach you, to perform in the land to which you are crossing to possess it, so that you will fear Hashem your God, to observe all his decrees and commandments that I command you, you, your children, and your grandchildren, your grandchild, all the days of your life, so that your days will be lengthened. You shall hearken, O Israel, and beware to perform them, so that it will be good for you, and so that you will increase very much, as Hashem, the God of your fathers, spoke for you. A land flowing with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, Hashem is our God. Hashem is the one and only. You shall love Hashem your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your resources. And these matters that I commanded you today shall be upon your heart. You shall teach them thoroughly to your children, and you shall speak of them while you sit at home, while you walk on the way, while you retire, and when you arise. Bind them as a sign upon your arm, and let them be ornaments between your eyes, and write them on the doorposts of your house and upon your gates.
Okay, Leonardo, 10 to 14.
Now, Now when Adonai, your God, brings you into the land that he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give you great and good cities that you did not build, and houses full of all good things that you did not fill, and cisterns dug that you did not dig, vineyards and olive trees that you did not plant, and you eat and are full. Then wash yourselves so that you do not forget Adonai, who brought you out from the land of Egypt, from the house of slavery. You must fear Adonai your God and serve him and swear by his name. You must not go after other gods, the gods of peoples around you. For Adonai your God in the midst of you is a jealous God. Otherwise, the anger of Adonai your God will be kindled against you, and he will wipe you from the face of the earth. You are not, you may get, continue?
Keep continue.
You're not to test Adonai your God as you tested him at Massah. Diligently keep the mitzvah of Adonai your God and his testimonies and his statutes that he has commanded you. You are to do what is good and right in the sight of Adonai, so that it may go well with you and you may go in and possess the good land that Adonai swore to your fathers, to drive out all your enemies from before you as Adonai has spoken.
Okay, Debbie? Do the rest of the chapter here.
Okay. If your child asks you tomorrow, saying, what are the testimonies and the decrees and the ordinances that Hashem our God commanded you? You shall say to your child, we were slaves to Pharaoh in Egypt, and Hashem took us out of Egypt with a strong hand. Hashem placed signs and wonders, great and harmful, against Egypt, against Pharaoh, and against his entire household before our eyes. And he took us out of there in order to bring us, to give us the land that he swore to our forefathers. Hashem commanded us to perform all these decrees to fear Hashem our God for our good, all the days to give us life as this very day. And it will be a merit for us if we are careful to perform this entire commandment before Hashem our God as he commanded us. Amen.
Okay, Angela, go ahead and read Deuteronomy 7, 1 through 11.
When Hashem your God will bring you to the land to which you come to possess it, and he will thrust away many nations from before you, the Hittite, the Girgashite, the Amorite, the Canaanite, the Perizzite, the Hivite, and the Jebusite, seven nations greater and mightier than you, and Hashem your God will deliver them before you, and you will smite them. You shall utterly destroy them. You shall not seal a covenant with them, nor shall you show them favor. You shall not intermarry with them. You shall not give your daughter to his son, and you shall not take his daughter for your son. For he will cause your child to turn away from after me, and they will worship the gods of others. Then Hashem's wrath will burn against you, and he will destroy you quickly. Rather so shall you do them. Their altars shall you break apart, their pillars shall you smash, their sacred trees shall you cut down, and their carved images shall you burn in fire. For you are a holy people to Hashem your God. Hashem your God has chosen you to be for him a treasured people above all the peoples that are on the face of the earth. Not because you are more numerous than all the other than the peoples did Hashem desire you and choose you, for you are the fewest of all the peoples. Rather, because of Hashem's love for you, and because he observes the oath that he swore to your forefathers, did he take you out with a strong hand and redeem you from the house of slavery, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. You must know that Hashem your God, he is the God, the faithful God, one who safeguards the covenant and the kindness for those who love him and for those who observe his commandments for 1,000 generations, and he repays his enemies in his lifetime to make him perish. He shall not delay for his enemy. In his lifetime he shall repay him. You shall observe the commandment and the decrees and the ordinances that I commanded you, that I command you today to perform them.
Amen.
Amen.
And I just want to say as we finish here that this Torah portion is all about Yeshua,
HaMashiach,
the Messiah of Israel.
Amen.